March 22nd, 2020. Unfortunately, we are unable to gather in our beautiful sanctuary, but we are pleased to be able to bring a service to you online. So welcome to all our members, as well as any guests that may be joining us in worship this morning. A few announcements. During this time of uncertainty and social distancing, our youth have volunteered to help. If you have concerns about getting out or running errands, please contact the church office. We have a list of youth and parents willing to help out. Please try to continue your gift to the budget and sanctuary renovation so we can continue with our expenses. You may mail it in or drop it by the church office. This will be greatly appreciated. Also, a thanks to those coming in this morning in preparation prior to making this online service possible. Cynthia Brown Stallings, Phil Warren, Pat Hodnett, Jim Hodnett, and Phil Suggs will be providing the music. Reverend Tom Scherer will lead our service and meditation. And thank you to Barbara Park for prior organization helping get this prepared, and to Christy Ramsey for the technology part and setting all this up and being here to make sure we get this service on our website and on our Facebook page. The link will remain on the website to view at any time, so please feel free to share with family and friends. And as always, continue to pray. One act of worship we can continue together is prayer. Please continue prayers for all of the Lord's people. Let us worship the Lord. Our call to worship this morning. Cry out with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into God's presence with singing. For the Lord is a gracious God, whose mercy is everlasting, and whose faithfulness endures to all generations.
Thank you. And let us pray. O Lord, O Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. We rejoice in you and in your presence among us, in your creative activity, in your providential care, in your God with us, in the person of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Oh Lord, this morning we praise your name, even though in these most difficult of circumstances, we find it difficult sometimes to say and do the things that we ought to do. We lift up our voices in the best of times, in the worst of times, believing, O Lord, that you will take care of us as you choose, that you have been with us in all of our yesterdays, you are now with us in this moment and in all of the time to come, that already you are in our tomorrows and even into all eternity the same. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. The heavens declare your glory. The firmament showeth your handiwork. You have made us, and we are yours. You provide for our needs day by day, the food for our bodies, and most certainly the food for our souls. You give in Christ the deliverance of sin and the promise of life that has no end. And Lord, while we are scattered about, we are bound together by your Spirit as the body of Christ, the church. O Lord, let us again and always be bound together by your presence, wherever we find ourselves. And let us continue, O Lord, to be your good and faithful servants. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Old Testament lesson comes from the book of Job, chapter 38, verses 1 through 15. The Lord speaks. Then the Lord spoke to Job out of the storm. He said, "Who is this that obscures my plans with words without knowledge? Brace yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstone? While the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy. Who shut up the sea behind doors when it burst forth from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and wrapped it in thick darkness? When I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place? When I said, 'This far you may come and no farther. Here is where your proud waves halt.' Have you ever given orders to the morning or shown the dawn its place, that it might take the earth by the edges or shake the wicked out of it? The earth takes shape like clay under a seal. Its features stand out like those of a garment. The wicked are denied their light, and their upraised arm is broken. This
And hear the word of God from Romans chapter 8, verses 31 through 39. What then shall we say to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, will he not also give us all things with him? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised from the dead, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake, we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You remember that Job was a very faithful and righteous man. He served the Lord God of Israel all the days of his life to the very, very best of his ability. And you will also remember that Job was a very wealthy man. He had much land, many a head of cattle, and sheep, and goats, and camels. He had all of the good things of life. He had a big house and a large family. What more could any man want who lived upon the face of the earth? Satan entered into a conversation with God and said, Will Job serve you for naught? Will Job serve you for nothing? If he loses everything that he has, will he continue to be faithful to you? Will he continue to be a righteous man? And God said, all right, you can take away all that Job has. You can do whatever you want to do to him, but do not take away his life. And as you know, Job lost all that he had, everything. All of his land, his cattle, his sheep, his goats, and the thing that just simply had to break his heart, he lost his children. And he goes and dresses in sackcloth and ashes, remaining ever faithful to his God. He still cries out to say, why, O Lord? How can this be? His wife tells him, why don't you curse God and die? Three of his friends come to him and get into a discussion, and they try to find out what he has done wrong, for indeed in those days it was believed that if you suffered, you had committed some terrible sin. And so they said, why don't you confess your sin, Job, and die? Whatever you've done wrong, just confess your sin and die. And Job said, no. Remember that he broke out in sores and boils. His life was as miserable as it could possibly be, and yet Job said, Whether we live or whether we die, we belong to the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Whether we live or whether we die, we belong to the Lord. I will indeed remain faithful. Even though he continued to ask why. Lord, why is this happening to me? Don't we do the same thing? Why me, Lord? Why now? Why us? Why is this happening in our world? I don't understand. And then Job said something, I think, that points us certainly into the New Testament. Job said, I know that my Redeemer lives. I know that my Vindicator lives and will stand for me one day. I know that my Redeemer, my Vindicator, that is, the one who will defend me, the one who will take care of me, lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, and he held on to that. And after Job has all of his time of asking God questions and wondering why this could happen in his life, God speaks to Job out of the whirlwind. And it's God's time to ask Job a few questions. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? That would be a jarring question, don't you think? Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Where were you when I was creating all of the things that you know in the world around you, the sun, the moon, and the stars, the lakes and the rivers, and the mountains? And he goes on to say, can you make the sun shine? Can you make the rain fall? Can you make the grass grow? That you may be fed, that your belly might be full? Again, pointing to God's everyday providential care. Can you feed the birds of the air, the beasts of the field, and the fish of the sea? Can you take care of those things? Who does that? Saying to Job, keep in mind that I am the Creator and you are the creature. And I can imagine Job just dropping to his knees and saying, oh God, you doeth all things well. You doeth all things well. No matter what is happening to me, you doeth all things well, and your understanding far exceeds my understanding. Who am I to question you? I had a friend in seminary who became a professor at Erskine Seminary, and he was asked to write a Bible study for the women of the church, and he liked to go to the beach. Now, he was not one to go out and get a suntan, but he liked to go down for the peace and solidarity that he could find walking along the seashore, so he spent a week down there writing this Bible study, and he said he would get up very early in the morning before dawn, have his own little time of Bible study and meditation and prayer, and then go out and walk along the beach as the sun was coming up. And he said one morning, it was just so foggy that he could hardly see the beach. And as he was walking along, he realized something that he knew, but I suppose had forgotten. That he could only see the sand at his feet. The fog blocked out his view in front of him, and the fog blocked out the view behind him. He could only see what was just at his feet. Is that not the way that we live our lives? We cannot see into the future. We don't know what is out there, and we can see very little of the past. We can only see what is at our feet, what God gives us in this time and in this day and in this hour. God indeed is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He knows all things, and no matter what is happening to us or to our world, he cares about us and loves us more than any other part of creation. Even when our hearts are broken and we're filled with grief and anguish. As you know, Paul had a change of life experience on the road to Damascus. He became a follower of Jesus Christ, the greatest apostle maybe of all time. And he said that indeed he believed in Jesus Christ, that he was born into the world, the incarnation, that he dwelt among us, that he suffered and died and was raised again, and he ascended into heaven and is sitting at the very right hand of God. This is what Paul believed and lived by. And as you know, Paul suffered greatly for serving Jesus Christ. He tells us that indeed he had a thorn in the flesh. He had a physical problem, we believe. We don't know what it is, but it was something that he had to deal with. And we know, because Paul tells us, that he was time and again stoned, thrown into prison, left for dead, and eventually sent to Rome to be held as a house prisoner until he could make his case before Caesar. And that ultimately he suffered a martyr's death under Nero's persecution. All of these things happened to Paul, great suffering in his life. But Paul could say in Romans 8 that nothing in the heavens above or the earth beneath can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ. Nothing in the heavens above or the earth beneath. Not peril, not sword, not famine, not nakedness. In those days, people believed that the stars had a great influence over your life. If you were born under a certain star, that would determine what your life would be like. Paul says, that's nonsense. That has no power over you. They believe that angels have a great influence over your life. Paul says, that has nothing to do with it. Nothing can separate you from the love of God in the person of Jesus Christ. Nothing in life, nothing in death. Nothing in this time or in the time to come. There was the notion indeed that there was be and will be ultimately a great transformation of all things, the end time. And Paul said that nothing in today's life, and certainly nothing in your future, nothing in the end time, in the great upheaval, can separate us from the love of God in the person of Jesus Christ. No powers, no principalities. How difficult it must have been indeed for not only Jews but Christians to live under the Nazi reign of terror in Europe. To live under Nero. Paul lived under the power of Nero and remained faithful to Jesus Christ, believing that there is no power, no principality, nothing in creation that can separate us from the love of God in the person of Jesus Christ. So then what do we have to fear? We live now in perilous times. We have seen an epidemic unlike anything in recent times. And certainly we are fearful. We are not sure what's going to happen next. We are afraid for ourselves and for our loved ones. And we indeed are deeply concerned about those, not only in our own country, but in the world around us, who have already been affected by this virus. But I think if there is a word of hope in this, is that whether we live or whether we die, we belong to the Lord, and that there's nothing that can separate us from the love of God in time or in eternity. God, to continue to love each other and serve each other and care for each other and pray for each other as well as we can, and continue to be the body of Christ. Continue in these difficult times to be the body of Christ, believing certainly that He will give to each of us all that we need in the living of life in these days. Let us pray. Oh Lord, we come to you again in prayer, confessing our misdeeds, our inabilities to do the things that we ought to do, that we at times have been selfish and arrogant, believing that we are the masters of our own destinies until we are crippled by a disease, by an event that we cannot control. Oh Lord, we pray again that we will understand all the more clearly who you are and who we are, that indeed you are the Creator and we are the creatures, and that you love us and care for us in the best of times and most certainly in the worst of times. And Lord, we pray now that indeed we will serve you for naught, that we will serve you as well as we can in these worst of days. And when, if you choose, as you will, to enable us to reach the other side, the end of this time, it can be said of us, well done, good and faithful servants, that you have been faithful over a little, I will make you faithful over much. Let us indeed continue to serve you in all of the days of our lives. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is
this morning that you will bless and keep those among us who have been stricken by this virus. We pray for their health and well-being. We pray, Lord, for those who have tested positive. We pray for those, Lord, who are grieving over the death of loved ones. We pray for our health care workers who are working diligently to care for the needy and the sick. Oh Lord, let us not panic, but let us be diligent. Let us follow the directions that we've been given. And again, let us trust in you. And now may the roads rise to meet you. May the winds be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face.